There are two types of patients of COPD. One is called the blue bloater, the other is called the pink puffer. The blue blotters are those who are edematous, who have water retention, who have poor kidney function, who have cyanosis, who are overweight and obese. Whereas the pink puffers are thin, cachectic, lean individuals with emphysema mainly, and then they have difficulty in respiration using accessory muscles of respiration and pursed lips. This age-old clinical classification of blue bloater and pink puffer, though still is important, we see a mixture of these two types of patients when a person is suffering from COPD. In general, the persons with chronic bronchitis and carpulmonale will look like blue blotters, whereas the ones with emphysema with underlying COPD are the pink puffers. It is important to grade the dyspnea of the patient, for which we normally use the dyspnea scale of the Medical Research Council of UK. This is called the MRC dyspnea scale. Grade 0 means no breathlessness except on strenuous exercise. This breathlessness is related to the activity of the person and classified. Grade 1 breathlessness is shortness of breath when walking uphill or while carrying or hurrying to catch a bus or train. Grade 2 breathlessness is walk slower than his contemporaries or he has to stop for breath while walking alone. Grade 3 stops for breath on walking 100 meters or after 2 or 3 minutes. Grade 4 is they are too breathless to leave the home or they are breathless even while routine daily chores like dressing. So it's important to assess the severity of the breathlessness of a patient of COPD so that we can see whether he is progressing with the treatment or his disease is worsening. For that reason, the grading of dyspnea is always essential, and also to tailor the treatment, the degree of breathlessness is one parameter which indicates what will be the stage of the COPD and then what sort of treatment will be required. This chart gives the differential diagnosis of asthma and COPD. How can we differentiate based on clinical and spirometric guidelines what is COPD and which patient is suffering from asthma? The history of smoking. Nearly almost all the COPD patients are smokers, whereas it may or may not be so in case of asthmatics. COPD is usually rare below 35 years of age unless they have a genetic defect like alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency or something like that. Whereas in asthmatics, nearly all of them are less than 35. Sputum in COPD is productive, whereas it is mucoid or none. Usually the COPD sputum is purulent, either greenish or yellowish. Dyspnea is persistent in COPD and progressive, whereas in asthma it is episodic and may be seasonal. Progressive course is the hallmark of COPD, whereas the asthma may have variable course or it may be static for some time. Spirometry results show obstructive picture in COPD may show normal values or may show obstructive picture. Reversibility, there will be less than 50% change after the administration of bronchodilator in the values of FEV1 and the FVC, whereas the change in asthma will be more than 15%, and we say the reversibility is the criterion for asthma. Most important treatment for COPD is of course ICS, short acting beta agonist and long acting beta agonist. Whereas in asthma, the most important treatment will be long acting beta agonist, LAMAs, long acting antimuscarinic agents and the inhaled corticosteroids. Antileukotrienes, they are of no use at all in case of COPD and they are very useful in case of asthma. So, the mainstay of treatment in case of COPD is long-acting beta agonists or long-acting anti-muscarinic agents and sometimes inhaled corticosteroids. Whereas in case of asthma, the treatment is inhaled corticosteroids are the mainstay of prevention of treatment, and they are the ones who have to be controlled on a long-term basis. Of course, short-acting beta agonists for their symptom relief, and sometimes long-acting beta agonists may be required to control the uncontrolled asthma. Antileukotrienes are not at all useful in COPD, they are quite useful in a case of asthma. These are some of the major differentiating features. However, as I told you earlier, the Swiss hypothesis believes that COPD and asthma are two separate diseases, whereas the Dutch hypothesis believes that COPD and asthma are different manifestations of the same obstructive lung disease. Nonetheless, we do have patients who have symptoms of both COPD and asthma, and asthma, if it is untreated, of course, not properly managed, will end up in COPD, and this sort of overlap is going to be a problem in distinguishing these two types of diseases. So, how do we go about? Anybody who is 35 years or more, if he has got the symptoms of cough, phlegm and breathlessness, cough, sputum and dyspnea for more than 1 month, he should be subjected to spirometry, and if the spirometry shows a picture of COPD, the diagnosis is confirmed. Or anybody who has these symptoms or has a history of exposure to smoking or occupational exposure to dust, indoor or outdoor air pollution, such an individual also should be subjected to spirometry. So, all those with either symptoms of COPD or with the underlying background of exposure to the noxious agent should be subjected to COPD diagnosis by using a spirometry. If the spirometry is positive, then the diagnosis is confirmed. We need to stage the disease depending on the results of the spirometry. This is the staging of COPD based on the GOLD guidelines. Stage 1 of COPD is called the mild disease, wherein the FEV1 is more than 80%. It is not at reduced below 80%, but the FEV1 FVC ratio is normally should be at least 75%. In this case, it is less than 70%. Stage 2 disease is called the moderate disease, wherein the FEV1 is between 80% and 50%, and the FEV1 by FVC ratio is less than 60%. Stage 3 disease is called the severe disease, where the FEV1 is between 50% and 30%, and the FEV1 by FVC ratio is less than 40%. Stage 4 disease is called the very severe COPD, where the FEV1 itself is 30% and the ratio of FEV1 FVC is also 30%. So, why do we need to stage the disease? It is because we require to manage the disease depending on the stage in which the patient presents. This patient with mild disease, the treatment requirement is different compared to the one who is in severe or very severe state. This we will look into the next slides. COPD, remember, is a systemic disease. Just like CKD, COPD is a systemic disease. What are the systemic changes that we see in a case of COPD? Muscle weakness due to cellular changes in the muscles, increased inflammatory markers, impaired renal excretion of sodium and water, with the result the edema and the blue blotter type of presentation. Peripheral edema can be either due to carpulmonale or due to the renal impairment of sodium and water handling. Majority of the cases of COPD, the edema that we see is due to renal water handling rather than due to heart failure. Increased metabolic rate causes cachexia, the pink puffer type of presentation, and bone resorption due to chronic COPD results in osteoporosis. Recently, an index based on body mass, the obstructive features of the spirometry, the dyspnea level and the capacity to exert is incorporated as an index called the BOD index. B stands for the body mass, O for the obstructive picture and the spirometry, D for the dyspnea as per the MRC grade, and E for the effort tolerance. That is called the board index. Here there are points are given from 0, 1, 2 and 3. If the body mass index is less than 21, it gives a point 0, 0 points. If it is more than 21 or equal to 21, then 1 point is given. FEV, even if it is more than 65 or equal, it's 0 points. 50 to 64, 1 point. 36 to 50, 2 points. Less than 36, 3 points. MRC dyspnea grade, which we have just now seen the previous slide, grade 0 1 dyspnea is 0 points, grade 2 dyspnea 1 point, grade 3 dyspnea 2 points, grade 4 dyspnea 3 points. 6 minute walking distance. If what is the distance the patient can walk in 6 minutes? More than 350 meters, 0 points. 250 to 349 meters, it is 1 point. 150 to 249 meters, it is 2 points. Less than 149 meters, it is 3 points. So, depending on that, the patients are assigned the points and the summated, the values are summated, and if the board score is 0 to 2, the mortality in 52 months is as low as 10%. Whereas if the board score is 7 to 10, 7, 8, 9, 10, the mortality is around 80% in 52 months. This is to say the board index not only identifies the severity of the disease, but also gives us a prognostic information and a prognostic guideline about what will happen to this patient and about the mortality information.